Today we have Miriam, one of our newest techs here, to discuss what it's like to be a new technician in 2022. So what is your education in the automotive field?
So I went to a four-year university where I studied engineering theory and got hands-on technical training in labs where I did everything from mounting and balancing tires to full long block engine rebuilds.
Oh, cool.
Very nice. What about you?
So I actually have zero formal education in being an automotive technician. I went to school for electrical engineering, but I just always had, always wanted to work my hands, loved cars. And when I got out of school, I decided to open up a shop. And back then, you can open up a shop if you want to, you don't need any special training, but I did obviously teach myself. And I ended up taking like supplemental training courses along the way for special things. I got my certifications and then I just kept continued on. So I'm really a self-taught automotive technician.
YouTube University?
No, there really wasn't much of YouTube when I got started. That would be more relevant for a 2022 technician. There's a lot of Facebook mechanics and things like that. Obviously having my shop was probably the best training I could get. Bringing cars in and doing work was really the best source of training. And,
right.
And I'm sure you would agree.
Absolutely.
How do you feel now coming out of school and being actually working in a shop?
Well, it's definitely a jump going from learning about the things that you're going to be doing to actually doing the things that you were learning about
right.
Every single day. So as someone who started out earlier than me, what do you do to make sure that you stay up to date on the new innovations in the automotive industry?
For me, I'm constantly looking at, they have a lot of like ASA trainings and things like that, where I actually make sure that I take those trainings. Some of the things that are really important is like electric vehicles. Like right now, that is the future. Gas engines, while they're still being produced and they're still relevant, EV is the future. Did you have any type of training for EV or hybrid?
Yes, there was a very large emphasis on hybrid training in my school. We did learn a bit about electric vehicles as well, but it's not readily available to the masses yet.
It's still new.
Right.
And it's funny because they did a big emphasis on hybrid vehicles, but even now hybrid vehicles are becoming a little bit obsolete. But that's okay.
Good thing I paid for all that.
Yeah, there's theory behind it that will build onto electric vehicles, that if you didn't have it, you'd be kind of starting from scratch. So I still think it's an asset
right.
to have learned about it. And they're not going anywhere. These cars that were produced in this 8 to 10 year period where hybrids were more relevant, they're going to be around and on the road for the next 10, 15 years. So you're going to need to have learned about them.
Mm-hmm.
And gaining your ASC certifications is huge. It's going to get you that next pay grade level. And I know, back in the day, just having your ASC certifications would get you the job, even if
right.
you didn't have that much skill, just having those certs, having those pieces of paper really helped out. So, I think all that is like super important, staying relevant, and obviously getting to that next pay grade.
I noticed when I was applying for jobs, it always said, or the description would say that ASC certifications are preferred, but not required.
So a big question is title. I know back in the day, people were called a mechanic, even way before my time. And, even when I started, I kind of liked it sounded a little bit more, more intriguing to be called a technician. But what do you consider your title?
I like to be called an automotive technician, but if somebody were to call me a mechanic, I wouldn't correct them. Sometimes I refer to myself as a mechanic.
Yeah, I got you. It's a little universal and a little easier to relatable for if you're talking to someone older,
if
you say you're a mechanic, they kind of understand. So what year did you start working on cars?
So I started working on cars around 2015 in my high school shop classes, though I wasn't actually hired as a tech until 2020.
Is that what got you interested in it? Was it that you had shop tech class?
I took the shop courses because my dad's side of the family is a bunch of gearheads. So that kind of led me down that path.
Okay.
What about you? When did you get started?
So I started in like the mid 90s working on cars in my driveway, working on my own cars. I didn't even have my license yet and I had already bought a car. And I would work on that in my driveway. And then in 2000, I opened up my shop. So I've been doing it for quite some time. getting out of school, did you feel like adequately prepared to jump into a job and actually work on cars?
I felt prepared in that I knew that I had all the knowledge that I needed. Or at the same time, I didn't feel prepared because I hadn't had the hands-on experience that one only gets from being in the position and doing that job every single day.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, working on the car is going to get you confidence.
Exactly.
Where learning it and knowing it is, you know, is a whole different ballgame. You know,
right.
It's needed, but it doesn't give you that confidence. I mean, I know, but I mean, tell our viewers, do you know how to drive a manual transmission?
I do know how to drive a manual transmission.
Do you think it's important, you know, in this time frame, 2022, as a technician to be able to drive a manual transmission?
I think that although it is becoming a little bit more obsolete, it is still important if you do want to be a tech, because you're gonna have customers that will own manual transmission vehicles that you need to be able to move around. And you can't expect to properly diagnose a manual transmission issue if you don't even know how to operate that vehicle.
Yeah, that's true. If you worked at like a classic car shop or something more sports car related, there are, most of the cars that roll in are going to be manual transmissions.
Right.
They're not going anywhere. You know, those old cars are going to be there. And I think even some new models are bringing back some manual transmissions because, you know, the masses wanted it. Getting started recently, I'm curious, what did you start out with tool-wise?
So I didn't have anything fancy to start. I still don't really have anything fancy.
Tools are expensive.
They are expensive. But yeah, I just have the basic hand tools, sockets, ratchets, wrenches, screwdrivers, multimeter, nothing,
okay.
Nothing special. What about you?
I mean, when I started, I just ran over to Sears. Obviously, I was super anxious, and I bought that, like, you know, they had the mechanics tool set, 356 pieces, you know, and it had, like, the basic hammer that you would never use, and, you know, screwdrivers and wrenches and, you know, metric and standard, the basic stuff. As I went on, I built onto it. I got a bigger box, and, you know, tool trucks started coming around, and, you know, you start buying them specialty tools. So, I mean, now my tool chest is, you know, expansive, and it costs more than, you know, all my cars and probably close to the price of my house, you know. but yeah, so I mean, I started low, and you know, you'll, as the years come on, being a new tech, you're gonna obviously start low and have, you know, a more expansive tool chest as you go on in the industry.
So as someone who owned your own performance shop, do you think that the car that you drive sort of tells a story about what you do?
Absolutely. I had a performance shop, so I always had, you know, cars that would kind of market for me, you know, kind of tell the story about what I actually did. Back in 2000, when I opened my shop, it was like the age of like import cars and things like that. So I kind of got into imports. I had my, you know, Integra Type R, which I actually have here today, that, you know, I've kept all these years. You know, I thought it was super important. And then as time went on, I got into different things like drifting, and, you know, I built a drift car, you know. And I think it does give, you know, a level of comfort to your customers about what you're driving, and, you know, that you can maintain and build these cars. So I do think it is pretty important. So what do you think? Do you think that there is any relevance to, you know, what you drive?
Personally, I'm going to have a lot of respect for the mechanic who has a car that's 20 years old, but they still have it running. Because to me, it shows that they know everything about that car. They know how to keep it alive, and I trust them to keep mine going.
Yeah. For me, I've always bought older cars, higher mileage cars.
Right.
It's cheaper and I can fix them. So I'll buy cars, you know, blown transmission, blown motor, get it cheap, fix it up, drive it for years, and then sell it for more than what I paid for it.
There you go.
As far as safety is concerned, I know, you know, back when I started, there wasn't, you know, a huge focus on safety. You know, obviously now as time went on, it's obviously a lot more prevalent, but like, how do you keep yourself safe day to day working in the shop?
Yeah, well, I mean, in school, they really drilled into us, you know, the importance of safety. So the first thing I do before I get started on any job is I put on my safety glasses. I've heard of people who get metal in the eyes and they have to go to a hospital. Not for me.
That was me.
That was him. You know, and if I'm working with harsh chemicals or oils or anything like that, I'll also put on gloves. And of course, there's the common sense safety practices like dropping the lift onto the lock so you don't get crushed, and, you know, not grinding around fuel.
All right. Yep, that's good.
No pyrotechnics
safe.
Around here.
Yeah, not only keeping yourself safe, but keeping the people around you safe.
Yep.
I like that. Super important. Do you think you're going to retire in the industry as a technician, or do you think you're going to move to a different path in the automotive industry?
That's a good question. Since I'm so new, I haven't quite decided yet, but obviously I got into the industry because I love working with my hands. So I think this is something I want to do for a while, but if the opportunity for growth or change presents itself, I might take it. You've been in the industry for a lot longer than I have, and you've kind of moved around within it. Do you see yourself staying in the position that you're in until you retire, or do you think you're going to continue to move around?
I mean, that's a good question. I have no idea. I really like what I do. What I do right now is a good hybrid of what I've been doing. So I started my shop, so I obviously managed. I had every role in my shop. And then coming here, became a technician full time, and then kind of moved back into the management aspect of it. I really love what I do. If my body can handle it, I want to constantly work on cars for the rest of my life. But I also do like to get out and kind of give direction to the shop and make it grow. So honestly, it's one of those time will tell type scenarios.
Yeah.
I really don't know where I'm going.
Well, that's a wrap on our video. I hope that you older techs watching have learned that us new techs really aren't so bad. Please be patient with us. We are still learning.
If you like this video, make sure you add a like, give us some comments on some new content that you might want to see. This is Miriam, I'm Nick, and we'll see you next time.